thank you all so much for coming. It is such a pleasure to be here. So yes, I'm going to be talking about root priming in Maltese. I'll give you a lot of background about the language. There are other kinds of priming in the language that have the opposite, that are phonological, not morphological, but today I'm talking about the morphological ones. Ask me at the potluck or tomorrow about the other way. Things might happen, and I will make some hints along the way. Also, yes, I have seeded my PowerPoint slides with some subtle advertisement for at least like going to Malta, if not doing fieldwork there. It's turned out to be a really, really wonderful experience for me. So the first half of the talk, or the first half of the experiments, are going to be a little bit of review from a recently published paper. That work was supported by NSF. The current stuff, not so much, unfortunately, but without the NSF stuff, we wouldn't have even gotten that far. And also, it's important for me to acknowledge all my colleagues and collaborators at the University of Malta, which has been incredibly supportive. I've been going there for fieldwork since 2004. And the people there at the Institute of Linguistics and the Department of Cognitive Science have been just wonderful. So I also want to thank the people who have been co-authors with me on experiments 3 and 4. So this is sort of a new project that began about a year and a half ago. So Michael Spanuel, who works in the Department of Maltese at the University of Malta, Hadass Vilan, who received her PhD after working in Ron Frost's lab at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, Andy, who you will hear from later, and Samantha Ray, one of my PhD students who does work in Arabic language processing and computational linguistics. So I'll give you some background about the language. I will do my best to like constrain myself because I could just talk about Malta and Maltese forever. Again, potluck party conversation. Ask me anything about Malta. From a linguistic perspective, this language is just so obsession-worthy. So Maltese is a Semitic language. It is a variety of Arabic belonging to the Western dialect continuum. And what makes it really interesting, a number of things, it's been heavily influenced by non-Semitic, so contact with Sicilian and then English later on. So its lexicon and grammar are really interestingly split between two radically different typological systems. I'm going to be talking today about roots. I'm going to be talking about auditory perception tasks. And one little slide about visual perception that I'll get to later. So the roadmap for my talk is, after I give you a little bit of background about the language and the place, I will do a super quick review of priming and spoken word recognition to sort of foreshadow the issues that I'm going to be investigating experimentally. The first two experiments are a look at root processing, and the last two experiments delve into some questions that arose out of that work, and then there will be a little conclusion at the end. So in case you aren't sure where this place is, it would be hard to see on this Google Earth image of North Africa and Europe, but Malta is right in the middle south of Sicily. We can zoom in and you get a sense of the scale. So these two islands here are the country of Malta. They're basically two main islands, the main island of Malta and the smaller island of Gozo. You can already see from the satellite image what the settlement patterns kind of look like, with much heavier settlement around this part of the island, and the distribution of the cities highlights that as well. So I live in a place that has about 1 million people. That's Tucson, pretty big, sprawly western city. So more than twice the population of this entire country. And Malta, area-wise, would fit very neatly within the city limits of Tucson and have room to spare. Tiny place. About 400,000 people. And there's, despite the small number of speakers, there's actually quite a bit of dialect variation, which is not something I know very much about, except that there are many dialects. People sort of maintain their identity about where they're from, village, town, city, whatever, a lot. One of the ways they do it is through dialect. So this language is descended from the variety of Arabic that used to be spoken on the island of Sicily, which was ultimately depopulated, and those speakers basically were forcibly moved to Malta. That's what most of the historical evidence seems to point to. And the country actually has two official languages, Maltese, of course, and then English, which is an artifact of British rule. So Malta was a colony of Great Britain for about 200 years since it sort of got Malta from Napoleon in the early 19th century, up until about 1964 when Malta became. Let me just briefly go over some of the ways that this language is unique in the context of Semitic, which will also give people a little bit of information about Semitic in general in case you're less familiar with it. So pretty much everybody in the country is bilingual to some extent. So early like native speakers of Maltese, and very much the case that people are also early native speakers of English, although there's a little more variety there. So Maltese is really the dominant language in the country, and especially since Malta gained official status as a European Union member in 2004, the language has really sort of seen an interesting resurgence. So the younger the speaker, the more likely you are to just encounter them using Maltese instead of English. Although I say that with a little bit of caution, because it kind of depends on socioeconomic status and where on the island you're from, etc. So it's a Semitic language, but it was cut off from contact with other Semitic languages, culturally and linguistically, a long time ago. So in the 11th century, as part of the Norman expansion, Malta was sort of reconquered after being part of the Arabic Empire, and the country, its identity, the identity of its inhabitants is like super European, super Roman Catholic, so these people do not identify in any way as Arabic or North African or anything. Linguistically speaking, the vocabulary is pretty evenly split, so there have been a few studies looking at counting verbs, nouns, adjectives, or just the whole lexicon, and seeing whether these words belong to either the Semitic layer or the Indo-European layer, and it's relatively evenly split between the two. Although if you look at, for example, a Swadesh list, like most of the words on that list are gonna actually be Arabic words. And interestingly, for people interested in things like word perception, especially in the visual modality, but also for other reasons, this is almost the only Semitic language that uses the Latin alphabet. I like to say it's the only one, but there's a few sort of newly documented cases of varieties of Arabic being like, used in like texting and stuff with Latin alphabet. But there's an established literary tradition in Maltese, everything. The oldest writing sample only goes back to the 1600s, but it's all in Latin alphabet. It also makes it easier from a very sort of like Anglo-centric perspective as a native English-speaking linguist for me to work on as opposed to having to learn an orthography. That's just a side effect. That's not why I chose Maltese. Here are some examples of what the Semitic side looks like. So like any other Semitic language, the Semitic vocabulary has a really rich and, I would venture to even claim, productive written pattern morphological system. So these are examples of words built out of the all-too-familiar root KTB. You've studied Arabic or you've done sort of basic morphological analysis on a Semitic language. You have encountered the KTB root before. And these are just examples of Maltese words that are built out of that, and I've highlighted them in orange. And similarly, the flip side of that is what's called the word pattern. Depending on what part of speech you're talking about, this term, there's other terms for word pattern like binyan or form or measure. I'm just going to use pattern for the moment, sort of agnostically. So this pattern, which has an M vowel prefix and a word medial vowel, is typically found in, say, nouns, for example. But that's really all these things have in common, and you can already start to see the sort of division of labor between what roots do and what patterns do. Roots tend to express very contentful semantic meaning. Patterns give you morphosyntactic information, lexical category, that sort of thing, that may become important. Further illustration of the bipartite system can be seen on the next two slides. So this one illustrates a paradigm of Maltese words built out of the root LSN, and if you just look over in the rightmost column and see the English translations, you can see that these all have a semantics in common. That'll become later on when we start talking about the types of things that can drive, say, facilitation of lexical access. And these medial, this middle column here illustrates the different patterns each. So these are built out of like arrangements between consonants and vowels. Sometimes a pattern comes with a prefix or a suffix. The first three examples are verbs, and verbs get assigned to special kinds of word patterns called binyan. And those have numbers, so I'm just giving you the numbers for reference. So this is typical Semitic Maltese paradigm structure. And this is Indo-European paradigm structure with a stem that is sort of closely related in meaning to what was on the previous slide, just for the sake of comparison. So all these words have to do with language or talking or linguistics. And you can see that all of these words are built concatenatively. So it's the stem lingua, and you've got suffixes and you've got prefixes, but that unit occurs uninterrupted throughout all of these words, which is of course very different from the consonantal root, right? Whose appearance is discontinuous and ordering among consonants and vowels. Crucially, it depends on the template that we're using. There's been a little bit of a debate about whether these things are actually productive. So Hoberman and Aronoff made a rather provocative claim in a 2003 paper where they said this sort of Semitic written pattern style morphology in language is frozen. Subjects or speakers don't have access to this. They can't like actively do novel word formation using this system. So this was a claim that my very first graduate student, Alina Twist, tried to address in her dissertation. And I think in a fairly convincing way, although I think more work needs to be done. But what she did was she ran subjects in a sort of WUG task where the WUG words were supposed to be nouns, and they were purposely organized such that half of them were designed to look Indo-European. So they use segments that aren't found in the Arabic vocabulary. They use prosodic structures that are found in the sort of Italian side of the language, and the other half looked Arabic with respect to those same features. And subjects were asked to do denominal verb formation. And the reason is that in the Semitic side of the language, you have this binyan system where at least at some point in the language there were productive denominal verb formation processes. In the current language still, people will borrow words, say, from English, and the way that they make verbs out of them is by applying a circumfix, which is a very concatenative strategy. But they don't change the stem in any way. So the way you do this is you geminate the initial consonant, and you add the suffix ya, which derives from the Sicilian verbalizing suffix yare. So you get a noun like iparchia means to park, for example, or downloadia means to download. Which is great, it's beautiful. And it means that like native speakers of English can sort of fake their way into making Maltese verbs because you can do that and people know, oh yeah, that's the verb. But interestingly, in Alina's study, like subjects really lined up categorically, right? If it was a Semitic sounding WUG, they used the Semitic written pattern system. If it was an Italian sounding WUG, they used the concatenative version. And one of my current students, Shiloh Drake, ran a similar study on the same items, but using a much less productive, less common process of diminutive formation and found complicated but similar results. And she's investigating this further in her dissertation. She's going to be running some artificial grammar learning studies. Okay, I want to switch gears a little bit now and just give a tiny background on priming because that's going to be the basic methodology that I adopt in the following studies to address this question of whether or not roots are at the basis of lexical retrieval in the language. So the basic idea behind priming is that in something like a lexical decision task, you can sort of influence a subject's behavior on what they're doing with respect to the target, depending on the nature of the thing that precedes the target, right? And in lots of studies on priming, right, the older studies use sort of like long lag priming, repetition priming, but then there's sort of, you know, what happens when an individual trial contains a prime immediately followed by a target. Repetition priming is the sort of most well-known version of this. I'm going to be talking more about this tomorrow. So if a target is preceded by itself as the prime, people are faster to recognize it. That previous exposure primes them to recognize the target when they get it. And other types of priming were found relatively early on in the literature as well. So a classic example being, say, semantic priming, like doctor versus priming. Interestingly, this effect is so quick, automatic, and early that it can happen even when the prime is not consciously perceived by subjects. So I don't have time, because I know that I've only got 45 minutes and then we have to do a few questions and go to the next talk. I won't demonstrate the visual mass priming methodology, although I will tomorrow if you come to the workshop. But one of my colleagues at the University of Arizona in 1984, Forster and Davis, published a paper in which they found repetition priming effects when the prime duration was reduced to about 42 milliseconds and preceded by a backward mask. They found repetition priming effects, and of course there's other kinds of priming effects in the literature on visual word recognition as well using this method like morphological priming and form priming. Those are the most robust ones. So the idea here is that when a lexical entry is accessed, even when it doesn't quite reach the threshold of conscious awareness, a prime, you know, if the subject is engaged in a lexical decision task, right, that's what happens when the prime enters their visual processing system. And if it's related in some way to the subsequent target, you get a facilitation effect. And people have different mechanisms for explaining exactly what's going on, whether you're talking about spreading activation, say, an interactive activation model, whether or not you're talking about something like a lexicon, lexical entry opening model, in Ken's search model, lexical access. I'm going to remain slightly agnostic about that for now. But you find these effects depending, well, you can get these effects with different types of relationships. Obviously, identity and repetition priming is the most robust kind, but related can involve semantics, although semantic priming is not as robust in the masked forms of digital mass priming studies. You can also find these effects when there's a form relationship, and that's going to play a role in the experiments I talk about in a little while, and also related to the experiments I'm going to talk about is morphological relationships between the words. So when the prime and the target are built out of the same morphological pieces. Those effects with morphology are particularly interesting in light of studies by, say, Karen Emery in the auditory modality. So she looked at bound roots in English. So submit and permit share this bound root mit, but it's really hard to diagnose any kind of semantic relationship between those. Nonetheless, in an auditory priming study without any masking, she found effects for that type of relationship independent of form overlap. So it wasn't just because the two things share the final syllable, although that is also a possible way to achieve that. With respect to morphology, the reason I'm interested in Maltese has to do with the context in which work on Semitic lexical access has taken place. A lot of the earlier work on Maltese, on Semitic languages, used this visual mass priming paradigm and tested native speakers of Hebrew and Arabic. And there's a bit of a problem doing that because subjects who are literate in those languages in those experiments have been trained in an orthography, number one, that represents consonants but doesn't consistently represent vowels. So if you're familiar with Arabic or Hebrew orthography, you know that vowels are sometimes orthographically represented, but they're sometimes not. In Arabic, for instance, long vowels have orthographic representations, but short vowels don't. In Hebrew, about half the vowels can typically have an orthographic form, but people are also trained in versions of your orthography where you don't even write those vowels. And in addition to that, many of the times, in a lot of these cases, subjects in these experiments are very well-educated people who have been trained in the orthography of their language. And because the orthography kind of presents the morphology to you, right, it might be the case that we're over-interpreting these results. Although, as you'll see, I think the Maltese case just ends up cementing the ideas that come out of those results. In addition, partly because I'm trained as a phonologist, I'm more interested in spoken word recognition, which of course involves a lot more work. I'll talk about that tomorrow in the workshop. But that's another way to minimize, not eliminate, but minimize orthographic influence. So let me just briefly go over some of the earlier work on roots and psycholinguistic evidence for roots in Semitic. So Frost et al. Have done a series of studies in Hebrew using visual mass priming. These are the sort of earliest studies to do this, and they found very consistent effects of root priming both in nouns and verbs. And in a paper that we're currently revising and hopefully resubmitting soon, we get the same effects as what I'm going to talk to you in a minute about Maltese in the auditory modality. In Arabic, Boudelon, Mars, and Wilson have a series of papers, including a recent one from last year, that find similar effects for root priming across modalities. So they've been really nice about testing visual mass priming, cross-modal priming, and auditory priming. For the most part, with respect to consonantal roots, the results are very consistent. Another one of my grad students did his dissertation work on Moroccan Arabic and found consistent effects of root priming using auditory mass priming. And I mentioned Alina Twist's work, her other dissertation experiment looked at visual mass priming in Maltese. So across the board, roots seem to facilitate lexical access regardless of modality. So in a sense, what I'm about to talk to you about, Maltese, is just another example of this. Now, of course, when you're looking at morphology, I think I might have hinted at this earlier, morphology, much of the time, is sort of a conflation of form overlap and meaning overlap. And so it's important, to the extent that it's possible, to try and tease out effects of meaning relationship and phonological or form relationship before you can really claim with confidence that the effect you're getting is truly morphological. So this is a very common objection we get in reviews, right? If we have failed to include like a phonological priming condition in our experiments, why are we interpreting our morphological priming results the way we do? So this talk today is sort of a response to that objection. Here's a nice example from the first Frost et al. Paper on visual mass priming in Hebrew that compared prime-target pairs with a clear semantic relationship, so M plus S plus is what that means, versus prime-target pairs where the two words are built out of the same consonantal root, apparently, but the semantic relationship between the words is really unclear. So they call that M plus S minus. So in all of these prime-target pairs here, the target is taklit, a record. It's like a record that you play on a record player, that kind of record. So the prime hakrata, recording, is clearly semantically related to that, but the prime klita, absorption, I think you can probably see what the semantic relationship like historically might have been, but native speakers don't recognize those two words as semantically related. They did a little bit of pre-testing. The right-hand column is trying to illustrate that there's a significant priming effect regardless of whether the prime is semantically related to the target or not. Is that clear? This is going to be important because this is going to inform the design of the experiment further down the road. So in terms of models of lexical access in spoken word recognition, so I'm sort of switching gears now, I'm not talking about visual word recognition anymore, you find a variety of models that basically fall into three camps, right? So there are models that propose that when a word is morphologically complex, we obligatorily recognize it on the basis of its morphemes. So these are the obligatory decomposition models. There are the hybrid models, say, Bayan's done some work on those, that have at least a possible route for recognizing words on the basis of their morphological constituents. And then there are other models that don't do that, right? But these models are the ones that are consistent with the well-known effects of morphological root priming in Semitic languages. So I'm going to start by going through a couple experiments in this recent paper, and then I'll get to what I think is maybe even more exciting, which is experiments, especially experiment three. So all of these experiments use an auditory lexical decision task where subjects are listening to pre-recorded pairs of primes and targets, and their job is to decide whether the target is a real word of Maltese or not. And so we usually have three, although in some experiments, four priming conditions. So we have a repetition or identity priming condition where the prime and the target are exactly the same. And that's where we would hope, if nowhere else, to get a facilitated reaction time in response to those words, right? The condition of most interest is the one where the prime and the target are different words built out of the same morphological constituent, so morphologically related. And again, if the root is going to be helpful toward word recognition, we expect to find a facilitation effect there. We're going to have then an unrelated or control condition, of course, to get a baseline priming reaction time. So we're going to use two kinds of priming. Experiment one uses audible primes. Maybe this is something that you're already familiar with if you're familiar with working in lexical decision in the auditory modality, no problem. Masked primes in the auditory modality is probably something that's fairly new sounding or impossible sounding. I will try and deconstruct it. And by the way, the workshop I'm doing tomorrow is about that, if you're interested. So again, experiment one, audible priming. Experiment two, mass priming. There's a couple other experiments in that paper that look not at roots, but at the bignon or the word pattern. I'm setting that aside, but ask me at the potluck. Really unexpected results with those. Okay, so we had about the same number of subjects in each experiment, but no subject participated in one experiment. These were done in 2010, and these are just sort of the methodological details. I don't think I have time to go through these in detail, but they're all pretty standard things. We used E-prime in these first two experiments. We collected a reaction time for the response box, and our reaction time measures that you're going to see are based on reaction time from target onset, but when we look at target offset, the results are the same. There's no difference in the patterns of results. We just get a lot more data we have to throw away because we have a lot of negative reaction times. People will respond at the uniqueness point, which is close to the end of the word, but not quite. Okay, so as in any lexical decision task, half our targets were real words, half were non-words. Because one of the experiments involved audible primes, we also had two lexically incongruent prime target conditions, just so the subjects couldn't develop a strategy where they could guess the lexicality of the target based on the lexicality of the prime. So those were all crossed. All of our items came from, they were all verbs that came from the most heavily populated verbal bignonim of the language, and that was documented in an earlier paper we published based on some corpus work we did. And we use a standard counterbalance Latin square design. We have 12 items per condition. And just some details about the words that I'm going to skip over. Importantly, our non-words were all phonotactically, phonologically legal non-words. They were all created out of nonce consonantal roots. So we just generated a complement set of roots to what actually are attested and what is actually possible. We took away anything that, say, violates like the OCP or anything that would be a dead giveaway to a subject that this isn't a word, right? These were vetted by native speakers. And this, we just used script to put things together. So for example, in our unrelated condition, we tried not to have any formed overlap between primes and targets so that they were truly unrelated. Ray Fabry, a professor at the University of Malta, came to Tucson a couple times, sat in a sound booth for many, many weeks, and recorded all these words and non-words for us. We took the best of three tokens, and in the first experiment, we had an interstimulus interval of 150 milliseconds between the prime and the target. So I'll play these for you, because it's always fun to hear Maltese. These are examples of prime-target pairs in the three conditions. And just so you know, these are given in Maltese orthography, and the letter Q in Maltese is used to represent a glottal stop, which is the sort of sound change from a historical uvular. So these sort of go in columns. So identity,
in affair, in affair,
related,
affair, in affair,
and unrelated,
village, in affair.
And these are what the results look like. So I've got reaction times and then a little net priming graph, which I'll explain in a second. But basically, you want to compare the unrelated condition against the other two. You can see that in both the identity condition and related condition, we have a nice big fat facilitation effect, so people are faster to recognize a target when it's preceded by itself or by a verb built out of the same root. For the net priming graphs, the zero line is basically the mean reaction time for the unrelated condition. Bars that go above that are positive represent facilitation. If bars go below that line and are negative, that's an inhibition effect, which we don't see here. But these are statistically equivalent, nice fat facilitation. Also, for non-words, we also put our non-words in the same three priming conditions. And so this effect is not actually surprising. So it's been shown in earlier work on auditory word recognition that when a non-word prime is followed by itself as a target, people are faster to reject it. They've already done the search, let's say, and they know that it's not lost, and they can say no faster. And interestingly, it doesn't matter if your non-word prime was built out of the same root as the target. That doesn't help you at all. So this is just standard non-word repetition facilitation. Okay. Experiment two is the same materials, but what's different is how we presented the primes. So in this experiment, we used Cuiter and Dupuy's subliminal speech priming technique. I call it auditory masked priming just to make it sound a little bit analogous to visual masked priming, although maybe these things are not quite the same thing. I don't actually know. I have to say, I'm still like mystified that this does anything. But you'll see that it does. So we mask our primes, and the idea here is that by doing this, you can sort of sneak in an auditory percept that is not consciously perceived. So it's meant to be analogous to this well-known visual mass priming method. And you do this by compressing the prime sound file to a short duration relative to its original duration. So we use a 35% compression rate, which is the lowest compression rate that Cuiter and Dupuy used, where they didn't get prime awareness, but they still found repetition priming when they looked at French. So they looked at a bunch of priming conditions, repetition priming, form priming, semantic priming, and the only cases that they found that were in the, that were, where there was no conscious perception of a prime were repetition priming effects. And nonetheless, I wrote my NSF grant and said, oh, what the heck, we'll try this with Maltese and with Hebrew. Maybe if there's going to be morphological priming anywhere, maybe we'll find it there, right? So that was sort of, you know, we based this on their failure to get an effect. We didn't know what would happen. I will go over many more details of how we produce these things in the workshop tomorrow. I'll give you guys the script that we use and some sound files to practice with if that's of interest. This is sort of what it looks like. So let me explain this picture, and if you come to the workshop, then you'll be super prepared. So this is what a typical trial looks like. So time starts here and goes this way. And it might be hard to see, but this is the word mask, And these things also say mask. Those represent individual different words that we use as masks. And the reason that they look funny on the screen is they get compressed. That's why the letters are like visibly close to each other. And each mask word is temporally reversed. And the result of that is that you get something that sounds like background speech or cocktail party conversation. So there's a forward mask that precedes the prime. And then there's the prime, and you can see that the prime is durationally compressed, but obviously we would like it to be processed, so we don't temporally reverse the prime. So you can think of this as like a, you know, two hands playing a piano, right? Where one hand is playing this line down here, so these are in sequence, and the other hand is playing the target. The other thing that we're trying to visually encode here is that the target is played at normal volume, but the masks and the prime are played at a softer volume. So you probably want to hear what some of these things sound like. So these are some English examples. And I can already tell you, so you don't have to be doing a lexical decision task. Maybe just do a lexical identification task. What target word is this when I play it? See if you can hear.
Not so cool.
Can you hear that? Let me make it a little louder. Yeah. Let me see what happens.
Not so cool.
Cool. It's just the word cool. Let me play it again, maybe listen for the prime. Obviously there are fans and fluorescent light vibrations and people moving in their chairs. This is not what it sounds like in the lab with headphones, right? But you can hear it later with headphones, just come and talk to me. So here's that same example.
Not so cool.
Probably can't hear the prime. This is a repetition prime, it's the word cool. I'll play it one more time.
Not so cool.
Maybe once you know it's there, you can sort of pick it out. Here's another example. This is not a repetition prime.
Fig.
English word is fig. Good.
Fig.
And the prime in this case is a formulated prime. It's the word fog, so it's a neighbor of fig. And the last example here.
Jail.
Jail. You see, you guys, three examples and you're getting really good, right? We usually give our subjects in Malta 10 or 12 practice items, and by like the fifth one, they've got it down. Their conscious strategy that they self-report to us is, because their accuracy rates are in the low to mid-90s, just like in the auditory priming with audible primes. And when we ask them, like, wow, you did really well. This is hard. How did you do that? They say, oh, well, I just had to tune out all that noise, right? And I focused on the loud thing, right? So that also tells us, as you'll see later, we have other somewhat indirect evidence that they're not consciously aware of the primes, but we'll get to that later. So in experiment two, again, the same materials as experiment one. This is what these things sound like in Maltese.
In affair.
Whoops.
Don't look at that.
Here's the related one.
In affair.
And unrelated.
In affair.
And they probably all three sound the same too, right? Yeah, so that's, which is normal. That's the case. Even to Maltese speakers, they do. Although, again, they're in a counterbalance list situation. So each subject would only get one of those. Okay, so here are the exciting results. These look shockingly like the results from experiment one. Nice, strong facilitation in the repetition condition and also in the root-related condition. The effect size has gone way down. That's not surprising. But these effects are very reliable. And so we've done these with ANOVA, with linear mixed effects. It's all the results are all the same. So here's an interesting piece of evidence that this effect number one is lexical and that it's, in this experiment, not about conscious awareness. So notice the lack of repetition priming effect for non-words here. It's gone entirely. So with respect to whether or not they could hear these things, we talked to the subjects after the experiment, and you know, they're like, oh yeah, those first two practice items were really hard, and then I just figured out what I had to do. We also, they get feedback. They get correct and incorrect, you know, so we want them to do well. And I'm so lucky that our subjects in Malta are just wonderful. They really want to do well for us. So we're paying them, but not that much, and they don't really do it for the money, and a lot of the times we have to really twist their arms to take the €5. This is consistent with Cuita and Dupuis effects, although they also ran like actual prime awareness tasks as part of their experiments, which we didn't have time to do. But the fact that they aren't reporting anything other than tuning out the noise, plus the fact that the non-word repetition effects go away when it's masked, really, we feel pretty confident that these things are not being consciously perceived. So the second and fourth column here are the Binion experiments, but the results are the same. So these are the audible primes, these are the masked primes, and what we see here is this, the facilitation effect in the repetition condition only when the primes are fully audible, but otherwise no effect at all. So roots seem to facilitate lexical access, the consonantal root is important, and either you're a hybrid model or an obligatory decompositional model, but you're happy either way. But you can't just be a whole word model. Really explain these results very well. And by the way, if you know any of my previous work before I was an experimentalist, you probably think, wow, that's really different from what I used to think. And that's very true. Okay, so this is the first documented effect of morphological priming using this technique. So Kuiter and Dupuy didn't find it. Kevin Schluter subsequently found it in Moroccan. And of course, it mirrors what Alina Twist found in the visual modality. Interestingly, in recent work that we've conducted on Scottish Gaelic with native speakers on the island of Skye, where we're comparing verbs with initial consonant mutation to verbs that don't have initial consonant mutation, where initial consonant mutation is this crazy, wild morphological process that is somewhat opaque, we get exactly the same effects there, which is interesting, especially in light of the fact that it's about the initial consonant, where like a lot of lexical access seems to depend on what happens at the beginning of the word. Okay, I'm going to get to experiment three very quickly here. So again, I mentioned earlier that you know, these effects could have to do with either semantic overlap between our prime target pairs, it's a hypothesis that I'm not ruling out yet, or just form overlap between our prime target pairs. We did some post-hoc analysis on looking at certain types of form overlap, like prosodic overlap or vowel identity, and when we split our items up on those bases, we don't get any difference. The priming effects are equally robust across all those different combinations. Experiment three goes one step further. And takes advantage of a really cool aspect of the language. I think the closest anybody's come to doing this is other work by Frost et al. In Hebrew, so in experiment four from their 2005 paper. They had a form-related priming condition where the two Hebrew words shared the first and the third root consonant, but not the middle root consonant. And they compared that against a morphological condition where the two words shared all three consonants. And they didn't find any effect in the form of But Maltese, I think, allows us to go one step further because we can actually do something really cool and look at a case of total consonant overlap with the absence of a morphological relationship. So let me tell you exactly why, what this means, right? I mentioned before that the language has this split lexicon. So what you can do is you can, you need a Maltese native speaking collaborator. Thank goodness that Michael Spaniel was interested in this. He spent a year coming up with pairs of items where one member of the pair was from Semitic and the other member was not Semitic, and the two words happen to share just their consonants, right? Aha. There can't be any morphological relationship. We avoided pairs where there was an accidental semantic relationship. There's no etymological connection between those things, right? In addition, within the Semitic vocabulary, you can find pairs that look like the M plus S minus condition from the Frost et al. Paper I told you about before, where the two words don't share semantics, but they happen to share phonology. So synchronically, you would think they have the same root, but that would be ridiculous. You'll see some examples in a minute. So we can test whether prime target pairs that have these characteristics produce the same type of priming effect that I just reported in the first couple experiments. So we're going to look at three conditions to test the hypothesis that what we saw before had to do with form overlap, phonological relationship between things, or semantics, right? If Maltese is like Hebrew, we should expect that these pairs that are Semitic, where there's no semantic relationship, should nonetheless continue to show priming. So in this case, we have two fixed effects. We've got our priming condition, and we've got our etymological source, sem for Semitic, non for non-Semitic, in the slides that follow with examples. And in our related priming condition, so we have identity related and control, these are how we divided up our related items with respect to etymological source. So for instance, we had Semitic prime, Semitic target with no semantic relationship, so sfar and safar, turn yellow and whistle, very semantically, just don't write. I don't have time to play these examples for you, sorry. We have similar kinds of pairs where the two words are non-Semitic, so korot and karota. And then the really exciting pairs, right? So non-Semitic prime with Semitic target, so kobra kiber, and the other way around, so vinya banyu, for example. In this case, we had 96 items with 8 per condition, and then everything else here is standard, so I'm gonna skip it because time is running out. These experiments were done with DMDX, 79 speakers in the first in experiment 3, and basically the results look like this. So what you see here is that there's only a significant or reliable priming effect in the identity condition. So I've divided these up by etymological source and priming condition, and you can see that the numbers are not like super, super consistent. So some of these are faster than others, but there's no interaction between these two factors, and the only significant effect we found was facilitation for the repetition priming condition. But if you look at that related row and compare it to the unrelated row, there is no difference between those. So if you look source by source, again, these graphs will just show you repetition priming, repetition priming, repetition priming, repetition priming, and it doesn't matter whether the prime target pairing is etymologically congruent or not. So expected identity priming, no form priming. So phonological overlap alone is not responsible for the priming effect that we found before, is what we interpret these results to mean. So I would like to say that the phonological explanation for experiments 1 and 2 is off the table completely. Interestingly, the semantics are behaving a little bit differently. We don't get svar priming safar. And we should if Maltese looks like Hebrew or not. Hadas Bilan is not happy about this. She doesn't want me to be giving this talk. Well, that's maybe a strong statement. We also ran, with different subjects, a visual masked priming version of this experiment, and the results look essentially identical. The most important thing is that there's no priming in the relate, no kiber cobra priming. There's a slightly significant effect in the other direction in the svar safar pairs. Slight inhibition effect. But I'm not going to really say more than that because she's not convinced that she did the analysis as thoroughly as she wants to. We also decided to run a brief fourth experiment, this will be brief, I'm almost done, where we reshuffled the items in our unrelated priming condition. So because experiment 3 was based on the Frost et al. Paper, in the unrelated condition, primes and targets shared 2 of their 3 consonants. So even though we didn't find a form overlap effect in the related condition, I still wasn't convinced that we were comparing it against a proper control in which primes and targets didn't share any of their consonants. So this experiment happened because after the 79 subject in experiment 3, we looked at the results and we got really excited. And then I had a heart attack and said, wait a minute, we're not looking at the right baseline. We don't know that we're comparing against a truly unrelated condition. And so Andy and I emailed Samantha Ray, who created new stimuli for us by the next morning. And we also, this is sort of a pilot, we only took items from the Semitic etymological source pairing. So this experiment was much shorter. Really, really small experiment. Yeah, it only took 5 minutes. So we could get 42 subjects done in 4 days, which is great. And then we had to get on a plane. But so slight grain of salt for these results because the power is much lower here. But still, we're only getting a significant effect of identity priming. There's no related priming here. So this seems to further indicate that semantics, meaning somehow, is crucial to obtain the priming effect, right? So this is really interesting, and it actually relates to some work that's been done on morphological family size effects in Semitic. So Moscoso da Prado Martin et al. Have a paper in JML from 2005 where they looked at the relative family size for Hebrew words that were built out of the same root that were all in the same semantic field. And they found a facilitatory effect. The greater the number of semantically related words are in your family, the faster you are to just recognize any one of those words. That's not even in a priming context. Conversely, because these languages have these interesting things like svar, safar, where you have two different semantic, you know, fields indexed by what might be thought of as the same root, what they found for Hebrew was the more items belong to like different semantic fields, the more likely you are to get an inhibitory effect in word recognition. So it's not that semantics doesn't matter in Hebrew, and I think that that might be the key to explaining what's going on here, although because we're using the same basic task and design as the visual mass primate studying Hebrew where semantics didn't matter, I mean, I think we're left saying, okay, these two languages are not quite behaving the same way. So at least we can say that the earlier results we found were not driven by phonological overlap, and I think maybe there's a lot more work to be done on semantic relationships here. So this is my last sort of contentful slide, and I will end. So Maltese behaves differently from Hebrew. I think that's an important takeaway. Semantic overlap didn't have anything to do with root priming in Hebrew, but it clearly does in Maltese. The absence of semantic overlap results in the absence of a priming effect. So I think we need to be cautious in how we interpret, and especially how we generalize results. So what happens in one language isn't necessarily true for another, even if that other language is closely related. I think that's actually exciting. I think it opens up more hypotheses to be tested. It means more trips to Malta, which is great. And I also think that it motivates more research on a greater diversity of languages, which I think is very important. And that's it. Thank you very much.